I love Twisted Metal. I'd probably even put it in my top 10 gaming franchises of all time. But keep in mind, when I say Twisted Metal, I mean Twisted Metal 1, 2, Head On, and Black. Entries like Small Brawl and 2012 are just not a part of the Twisted Metal storyline. And Twisted Metal 3 and 4 are abominations that spit in the face of the series, in my opinion. Now, you've noticed I said the Twisted Metal storyline. And for those of you familiar with the series, you might be saying, well, sure, some characters have jumped between games, but they're not all connected. And that's what this video is about. I'm going to explain as if those watching are brand new to the series. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the main characters that do connect all four games together. So with that said, let's dive into what Twisted Metal is about. With 8 games released across 17 years, a one-shot comic from DC Comics, and a TV show releasing soon which looks just awful, Twisted Metal puts you behind the wheel of many different vehicles being controlled by many eccentric drivers as they kill their way through the yearly Twisted Metal tournament, which is held across many different battlegrounds. The lucky driver who wins the tournament will be granted a single wish by the all-powerful Calypso, regardless of price, size, or even reality. The first Twisted Metal was released in 1995 by Single Track and consisted of 12 playable characters fighting across 6 different levels. But we only need to discuss a handful of the characters when discussing Twisted Metal's overarching storyline. The character we're actually going to start with is not Sweet Tooth. We do need him later, but not right now. We are actually going to start with Mr. Ash. Mr. Ash is the driver of a GMC General semi-truck nicknamed Darkseid. He is described as a ravenous creature who wants to get back what is rightfully his. He's hoping Calypso can help him retrieve an item so powerful it could destroy the world. Upon completing the tournament, Mr. Ash meets with Calypso, who is not happy to see him. It turns out Mr. Ash's wish is to have his demon named Black return to him after Calypso stole it to use its powers. After Black flies into Mr. Ash's body, he leaves to return to hell while Calypso screams in agony. This story will become fairly similar in future games to the final boss of Twisted Metal, Minion. Minion is the name of the Lav 300 tank driven by an unknown driver. All that is known about Minion in the first game is that he was the winner of the previous year's tournament. But I have to mention him now because he does come up again later. The next character we need to talk about when discussing the first game is in fact the mascot of the entire series, Sweet Tooth, which is a Chevrolet Step Van ice cream truck driven by the murderous clown Needles Kane. His bio reads as, "An escaped mental patient, Sweet Tooth is a man on a mission. He has entered Twisted Metal in hopes of getting the one prize that means more to him than anything else in the world, his best friend." I know you're probably on the edge of your seat right now wondering, well, who's his best friend? How's it play into the whole story? But I am absolutely happy to disappoint you because nothing about Sweet Tooth in the first game is important for our storyline. The final important character in the first Twisted Metal we need to discuss is Yellow Jacket, the Checker Marathon taxi driven by Charlie Kane. He is described as an old and lonely cab driver from the streets of New York. He has entered Calypso's contest to learn what happened to his son, a young man who disappeared 20 years ago. Now, as if the twist isn't obvious enough based on just the names alone, when you win the tournament and meet with Calypso, it is confirmed that Charlie Kane's son is Needles Kane, driver of Sweet Tooth. Charlie is anguished by this news and at the thought of having killed his son to win the tournament, and speeds off into the night thinking about entering next year's tournament with the wish of easing his suffering. Now you'll notice something right there that I just said that immediately doesn't seem right. Talking about killing Sweet Tooth. The problem with Twisted Metal as a long form story is that your characters have to die every game. Technically only one character should survive each game. If you have all these people, then Sweet Tooth in game one, and Sweet Tooth is in game 2, none of the other characters in the first game should be there. But that's just not the Twisted Metal way. So if you can just turn that part of your brain off, moving forward, we can get back to the one major storyline. So let us move right along to Twisted Metal 2, which was released by Single Track in 1996 and is called The Perfect Twisted Metal by series co-creator David Jaffe. It features 14 playable characters and 8 levels with 3 more hidden levels for use exclusively in multiplayer mode. The game is set 1 year after the first, where Christmas Eve is soon approaching, and thus it will soon be time for another Twisted Metal tournament. But unlike last year, which took place across different areas of Los Angeles, Calypso wants to expand the fighting into different countries from across the world. With that said, let us look at our important characters. Firstly is Darkseid, who was originally planned as a mini-boss, but was cut from the game before release, even though they still appear in the background of the options menu. It doesn't matter for the story anyway, because they were planning on having a different driver than Ash, some grandma lady, teehee, Mad Marge, etc, etc. Moving on, Minion is back from the first game, but this time with a proper story. Still driving the Lav 300 tank, Minion is driven by the demon named Minion. They are a mini-boss that appears after completing Amazonia, along with the message, "Last year's boss rises from the lava. I must win, Calypso, and I have a score to settle," he yells, as he comes after you with a vengeance. Minion is also unlockable through the use of cheat codes, and thus, we are able to see what happens if he is the winner of the tournament. In the ending video for Minion, he meets with Calypso on top of the roofs of New York. He goes on to mention that Calypso stole his power 11 years ago, which would have roughly been around the time of the first Twisted Metal tournament, and then sends Calypso back to hell, all of which is very similar to the story of Black and Mr. Ash, and has even led many to speculate that Mr. Ash is responsible for both Black and Minion, although I was not able to verify this. Next, we discuss Sweet Tooth, who is also another character unlockable through codes. Sweet Tooth is still a Chevrolet Stepvan ice cream truck being driven by Needles Kane, but this time with his signature head on fire look. His profile says, "My first home was the circus. My second home was the State Institute. My next home will be yours. I will be the man who hides under your bed, in your closet, in your mind. When I win, you'll never be too far from me." So what does that boil down to? Well, when you win the tournament as Sweet Tooth, Needles wishes to simply become a bug in a tiny garden, as it will be a much simpler life for him. And that's it. Not a whole lot of anything interesting going on with him yet. He's kind of a blank slate. Our next character is one that most people do not actually associate with Twisted Metal 2, and that's Charlie Kane, who last year drove the Yellow Jacket. This year we don't see him at all. Until we get to the final boss and meet Darktooth, an oversized Chevrolet Stepvan ice cream truck. He appears at the end of the Hong Kong level with the message, "Darktooth, Sweet Tooth's father rises from the sewers. You killed my son," he shouts. "I want my little clown boy back." It's funny, because that message will also play even if you're using Sweet Tooth. I think Charlie Kane in the Darktooth is the first real example of something carrying over from a previous game. We're going to see more and more of that as we go along. But in Twisted Metal 2, we also get introduced to the final important character, and by far the most important character. And that is Roadkill, which is a piece of junk Pontiac Firebird being driven by Marcus Kane. Marcus Kane is immediately one of the more interesting characters among the first two games. As his bio says, "I know the truth, you freak. You sit back in your living room with your little video game console and play, play, play. But I know what's happening. I can see you. They think I'm crazy, but you'll find out I'm the only one who's sane." With time, we will come to find out how accurate that actually is. In the meantime, Roadkill's prize for winning the tournament is actually one of the few good endings in the entire franchise, really. When he meets with Calypso, he begs to be sent back to reality. Calypso tells him that he always knew Marcus Kane would figure it out, and that he is welcome back anytime. There's a flash of light, and Marcus Kane wakes up in a hospital ward, where it is explained to him that he was involved in a massive traffic accident. He mentions how he recognizes some of the other victims, as the camera pans out to show the drivers of other vehicles in the game in comas. His wife and two daughters run up to him and give him a hug, and with a flash of Calypso's face on screen, the scene fades out with a happy Marcus Kane and family. And with that happy ending, we move away from Twisted Metal 2, which is my favorite in the series by far, and into the dark times. After a contractual dispute between Single Track and Sony, the Twisted Metal franchise was taken away from Single Track and given to 989 Studios. They would go on to make Twisted Metal 3 and 4, but would never capture any of the magic of those first two games. They had a different engine in the first two games, thus changing a lot of the physics and game feel, and were generally more cartoonish with their humor, thus making it just kind of feel like childish compared to previous entries. And no one, absolutely no one, likes a silly Twisted Metal. And even though many of the characters from the first two games appear in 3 and 4, they have nothing to do with the Twisted Metal canon. And thus, we're going to ignore these two games and skip right on to the fifth entry in the series. One that sets out to correct the problems of 3 and 4 in many ways. After losing the rights to Twisted Metal, Single Track would later be purchased by GT Interactive. A year after this purchase, many of the ex-Single Track employees would leave to form Incognito Entertainment. And upon signing with Sony, now had both the rights to Twisted Metal, along with a majority of the creative team from the first two games, and thus were greenlit to create a new Twisted Metal. Hoping to return to a more mature-feeling game compared to Twisted Metal 3 and 4, Twisted Metal Black was a whole new experience. Twisted Metal Black was released in 2001 by Incognito Entertainment and features 15 playable vehicles across 11 different levels with 8 multiplayer-specific levels. This game's setting is different from the usual Twisted Metal tournament plot. Instead, this game takes place across various locations in Midtown, with the contestants all being patients of the Blackfield Asylum. That's where they met Calypso, who agrees to release them if they enter his tournament and will offer the winner a wish related to their incarceration. Let's see what our characters are up to in this different and darker Twisted Metal. Darkseid is back as a Peterbilt 379 semi-truck, but this time being driven by Dollface, a teenage girl who had a mask nailed then locked to her head by her boss for spilling his coffee.
She spilled my coffee.
I'm sorry, sir.
You fucking bitch.
Other than the name Darkseid and the vehicle being an all-black semi-truck, there is nothing about Dollface that relates to Mr. Ash from the first game, besides both being fucking awesome. But that doesn't mean his influence isn't felt in this game. But we will get to that yet. Yellow Jacket is also back as the classic Checker Marathon taxi cab, and it is even driven by Charlie Kane, or at least Charlie Kane's corpse. You see, Charlie Kane was a happy man driving taxi in Midtown. He would even take his youngest son to go driving with him some days. Anything to distract the two from the murderous oldest son who drives the ice cream truck. Then one day on the job, a passenger shot Charlie in the head and ran, right in front of his youngest son. Horrified at the idea of being alone without his father, the son set about building a mechanism that can allow Charlie's corpse to be controlled via remote control. Of course, everyone around the boy thinks this to be wrong and unhealthy, leading to his incarceration at Blackfield Asylum. So how does Charlie Kane and his youngest son play into the story this time? They don't. I just thought it was nice to see a person we recognize driving a vehicle we already knew. But what about the eldest Kane son? Sweet Tooth is now a Dodge Power Wagon ice cream truck, once again driven by the series mascot Needles Kane. In this game, Needles Kane was eventually captured and put up for execution after his numerous murders. A preacher was present for his electrocution, under the assumption he was there to save Needles' soul. But as electrocution begins, the preacher instead prays for a curse on Needles that will have him burn in the flames of hell forever, rightfully so. Needles' head catches on fire and he proceeds to break free and kill a large number of the guards present. Eventually, he is subdued and sent to Blackfield Asylum, where every day since, the pain has gotten worse and worse. Eventually, Calypso visits Needles and offers to remove the curse if he wins his contest. Fast forward to the end of the contest, and Calypso offers Needles a vial of the preacher's blood, telling him that by drinking this, Needles can remove the curse. But if he goes back to committing murder, the curse will come back. With this info, Niels immediately smashes the vial of blood and kills Calypso, setting out to become the greatest killer of all time. So what does that have to do with Twisted Metal 1 and 2? We'll get there, baby. Just keep it in mind. Twisted Metal Black had a handful of unlockable characters. One of them is a Bell B-40D dump truck named Manslaughter, which is being driven by one of the first people we talked about in this video, Black! Now, absolutely nothing is really known about Black in this game, except for the fact that he is out to kill Calypso, and that he was apparently sent by others to do so. Although it is never revealed from where he was sent or by who. Although, fun fact, one of the many things cut before the final release was actually a voiceover of someone explaining all of Black's actions during his cutscenes, and it is believed that this is Mr. Ash, although since it was cut, we can't say it's official. This doesn't sound like much to go on as far as the larger story goes, but trust me, what comes next finally starts bringing it all together. Our next vehicle is a Freightliner tanker truck named Minion, but it is not actually driven by Minion. But we don't know that at first. The only way to unlock Minion is to beat the game with all 14 other playable characters first. When you do, you'll be able to then select Minion as a playable character. As you go through their story, the loading screen will be filled with numbers instead of the usual quotes like other drivers. It is these really easily deciphered codes that really begin recontextualizing a lot of the game. Through these codes, we learn that the driver of Minion is none other than our old friend Marcus Kane. Also through these codes, we learn that Twisted Metal Black is all in Sweet Tooth's head, that this is how Sweet Tooth sees the world, and that the world that Marcus is from was much more colorful. This info begins to explain the jump to such a darker world compared to the Twisted Metal world we're used to. Another important thing it does is it sets up that the two worlds can exist simultaneously. So let's go ahead and skip Twisted Metal Small Brawl, which was released by Incognito Entertainment in 2001 and was aimed to capture some of that childhood-friendly audience that Twisted Metal 3 and 4 had established. Heading into 2005, Incognito Entertainment working on two very different Twisted Metals. The first being a PS2 sequel called Twisted Metal Harbor City, aka Twisted Metal Black 2, and a PSP game called Twisted Metal Head On, which would act as a proper sequel to Twisted Metal 2. Let's start with Twisted Metal Harbor City, since we just finished discussing Twisted Metal Black. Also, spoiler alert, it was eventually canceled, so there isn't going to be tons of information here. What is important is that some of our crucial characters are back with just a touch more story given to them. Darkseid is back and still being driven by Dollface, who is starting to grow older, maturing as a woman, and also suffering from pain and brain damage from the mask not yielding with the growth of her body. Charlie Kane and his youngest son are also back driving the Yellow Jacket. This time though, Charlie's son, who still hasn't been given a name, intends to kill his older brother Needles Kane and then kill himself, thus ending the Kane family's evil bloodline. Needles Kane is still driving the Sweet Tooth ice cream truck, of course, not just because he is the mascot of the series, but also because Black takes place in his head. Unfortunately, no new info is given for him, but he's not exactly been a deep character so far, has he? Finally, Black is also back, driving the Manslaughter dump truck, except this time he actually does have a story. It says, "No one knows where Black comes from, but he seems incapable of dying, and he has only one goal, to kill Calypso. The latest rumor is that Black actually comes from a parallel universe where a different, more colorful Calypso wants to use Black to murder his darker twin." We can confirm his lack of dying with Black's ending video in Twisted Metal Black, where instead of Calypso, a bomb is instead waiting for him, but after the explosion he gets up and gets right back into his truck before driving off into the night. Even in the PS4 release of Twisted Metal Black, the trophy you earn for unlocking Manslaughter is called Calypso's Nemesis. So seeing as we have the evidence to trust the Calypso murder plot, we can, by association, believe that there is the other universe and the other Calypso is sending Black on through. Speaking of Calypso, it's pointed out that his appearance in the Black universe is not only far different from the first two games, which we can confirm, but that he's actually quite similar in design to Sweet Tooth. He has a glass eye on the same side Sweet Tooth's mask is missing one. He is bald just like Needles, and his chest is also covered in scars. Unfortunately, I'm just a guy who likes playing video games. I don't really know what the idealization of murder and self-loathing and all that really means. I mean, if I did, my dating life would be a lot simpler. So let's move to the game that wasn't canceled and see what 9 years and an alternate universe has done to our main storyline. Released for the PSP in 2005 by Incognito Entertainment and for the PS2 at the end of its life cycle in 2008 by Eat Sleep Play, a new company, once again made up by the majority of the original Twisted Metal creative team that had left Incognito Entertainment. How many times are you going to jump ship? Holy shit. Twisted Metal Head On is the proper sequel to Twisted Metal 2 and features 18 vehicles across 10 levels, with an 11th level being PS2 exclusive. So, our characters. Is Mr. Ash driving Darkseid? No, we don't even get a doll-faced Darkseid, or any Darkseid for that matter, which is just such a sadness.
It's such a sadness.
But what about good old Charlie Kane? Also no, not even his kid or any sign of Yellowjacket, but Darktooth on the other hand. We'll be talking about him in a bit. Needles Kane is of course back, this time driving a Sweet Tooth that is now a Chevrolet Task Force ice cream truck. After participating and winning in numerous Twisted Metal tournaments over the years, he is feeling discontent with his lot in life. This time when he wins, he wants to switch places with Calypso. This results in them literally switching bodies, against Calypso's will of course. Once in Needles Kane's body, Calypso demands his guards apprehend Needles, which in classic Twisted Metal fashion results in the guards shooting and killing the body of Needles, which is housing the soul of Calypso. This actually does show a history between Calypso and Sweet Tooth, and that there's some sort of relationship between these two, that there have been previous Twisted Metals, that this is actually a proper storyline of some sort. Just a little hint. But that isn't all that Needles is involved in this time round. For the full picture, let us discuss our final character we've been following. Marcus Kane is once again behind the wheel of Roadkill, which is now a Junker Plymouth Roadrunner. And just like before, he knows deep in his soul that none of this is real. And when he wins, he wants to wish to be sent back to reality. The problem is, when he meets with Calypso, he is not granted his prize. He is told by Calypso that this reality is essentially his own creation, and continuously refers to Marcus Kane as Needles Kane. Calypso goes on to imply that this twisted world of twisted metal, so to speak, is exactly what Marcus Kane wants, or at least what the Needles Kane inside of Marcus wants. The video ends with Calypso teleporting Marcus back home, and when he wakes up, he looks at the camera as Needles Kane. Much like how for a brief moment in Needles' ending video, a reflection can be seen showing Marcus Kane's face. By gum, I think we have ourselves a case of split personality. Speaking of which, remember how we said we'd be talking about Darktooth? Well, as the bio reads, terrible things can happen when a man comes to grips with his dark side. Marcus has spent his life running from his nightmares. Needles has devoted his life to making his nightmares come true. When Marcus surrenders to Needles, the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Marcus's rational mind and Needles' fevered insanity descend into a vortex of sinister chaos. The only possible outcome is the total annihilation of anything that stands in their path. Thus, Darktooth. The coming together of both the personalities of Marcus and Needles into a single murderous Kane. When completing the story mode as Darktooth, there is no meeting with Calypso for a wish. Instead, we get a scene of Marcus in a field, who is joined by his Needles counterpart. After some banter back and forth, they somewhat come to the agreement to work together as one, with Needles quipping, "Too many questions. I think the best thing is to climb inside and look around." And what is it that they're climbing inside? Well, now that the two personalities are an actual true whole and working together, they drive the most dangerous vehicle of all, Tower Tooth, which is essentially a restaurant on a steel beam being driven by multiple Sweet Tooth looking ice cream trucks, with max stats for handling, armor, special weapon and speed, and being by far the largest vehicle to date, Tower Tooth is the deadliest enemy the Twisted Metal Tournament has seen. Now that the two minds have merged as well, it's a proper place to end the series in a way. Needles Kane's Twisted Metal Black Universe and Marcus Kane's Twisted Metal Universe meeting head on in one final showing. I say final showing because we do not count Eat, Sleep, and Play's 2012 Twisted Metal, which was really only meant to be a PSN minigame and ended up getting expanded into a giant piece of shit. And that is how all the Twisted Metals are connected, so to speak. Do I think it was some well-planned out plotline hidden in the background for only the most diehard fans to find? Absolutely not. It was very clearly a case of just adding on to what we already have. But that doesn't mean it wasn't fun to follow. There are so many times when the Twisted Metal universe would reference itself, or even just plain old spit in the fans' faces. Like, how about the fact we never got another Darkseid driven by Mr. Ash? Oh yeah, except in Small Brawl, or like when Needles Kane wishes to become a bug, but is back to being human in time for the next tournament. Cause after all, he has won multiple Twisted Metal tournaments, so he says. So there are many other characters who have stories that span between multiple Twisted Metals, but none shape the plot of the game quite like the main Kane family that we discussed here. So allow us to summarize what we just watched here. In Twisted Metal 1, we were introduced to our characters. In Twisted Metal 2, we got to see the continuation of story based on the carryover of Charlie Kane, as well as some of the other drivers that we didn't get to discuss. We also met Marcus Kane during this game as well. Twisted Metal Black was a supposed insight into how Sweet Tooth sees the world. It is said that most of the other drivers in the game represent aspects of Sweet Tooth's personality, but this was not the video to discuss a topic that broad, so we just kind of ignored that for now. We also got to see some of the continuation of story based on the appearances of both Black and Marcus Kane. Finally, in Twisted Metal Head-On, we got to see the culmination of Marcus Kane accepting both the world and Needles Kane as his creations, thus ending the story in a way that could be built upon later if more games were to come out, which is how, really, the whole series was kind of written. This whole story was kind of written in that build-upon way. And who knows? Maybe the new TV show will somehow get demand back up enough to see a new game get released. But if it did, it would have to reference a TV show a bunch. As well as it being 11 years since the last game, I doubt a new entry would hold up in any way. So with that said, I thank you for watching. I would love to see your comments down below on what you interpreted of this sloppily slapped together, chained on storyline from multiple production companies spanning years. What did you get out of it? What did you think? Did I interpret something differently? Who knows? Until then, have a good one. We'll see you next time. Later now.